to your one stop for all things entertainment. You're watching Unscripted on WION. I'm Pallavi Batra, and I'm taking you from Mumbai to LA and everything in between, but strictly entertainment. Our favorite Pete and celebs are back in the hood from the most happening city in the world, New York, the city of dreams. The concrete jungle where dreams are made of. There's nothing you can't do. Now you're in New York. And from the looks of it, it seems like they've all had a nice, big, fat annual family holiday, complete with inside jokes and high-fiving.
You became an actor because of your talent.
I think you launched me because of my talent, right? You gave me a break.
I think it was because of your papa.
But Sefu, you're also here because of your mama.
I'm in this industry because of my papa.
Actually, Karan, what song was that? Karan ke film mein gana tha na?
Bol chudiya, bol kangana, kangana.
Kangana na bole to behtar hai.
Well, it looks like Varun Dhawan has taken his award for best actor in a comic role way too seriously. But honestly, guys, there's nothing funny about these jokes except for the fact that they're cracked on a world stage and not in one of their living rooms. But at least they're humble enough to acknowledge their privileges, and that too in a very Bollywood style. Finally, Karan Johar has come out and apologized for his jokes and promised never to speak on this topic again. Quite filmy, don't you think? Dhawan too took to Twitter to apologize for his act, although we don't know which one. But it wasn't just K. Joseph and Varun providing us some comic relief at the IFA Awards. Salman Khan too gave us some.
So IFA rocks, and IFA is going to be fabulous. Promise you, it's going to be incredible. It's going to be one of the best IFAs. And the date, this date of, kabe? 15th? I'm not good with dates at all. Seriously. The only one date I remember right now is Katrina. Katrina's birthday. Birthday.
I feel you, Salman. I do have a problem remembering dates. In fact, I recently forgot my boyfriend's birthday. But it's not cool how Kamal Khan punished you for this. Aakhir galti to insaan se hi hoti hai na? Well, when you're talking about Salman, how can you not talk about Katrina? Well, irrespective of Salman, Katrina still deserves a special mention. Because she has proved that she can actually travel in time and be at two places at once. Well, according to the IFA editors at least. Don't believe us? Take a look.
Thank you, and may we all drive together to the new and memorable experience.
And that's why we always say, a good edit is really important. Really, really important. Well, in Alia's defense, she really deserved that award for best actress in a leading role. However, her singing made the rain gods a little upset. Whether the cameras are on or not, these celebs sure know how to keep their audiences entertained. And another thing they do know well is suit up and show up. And talking about showing up, Game of Thrones Season 7 showed up with Khaleesi showing up at Dragonstone. While we're just a few sleeps away from Episode 2, Episode 1 has gone and created TV history. Here's how.
We will defeat it. We're the last Lannisters.
Game of Thrones debuted in 2011 based on the fantasy novel A Song of Ice and Fire, authored by George R.R. Martin.
I was born to rule the Seven Kingdoms.
The series boasts of 6 seasons so far, with reportedly the most ardent fans in pop culture history. When the long-awaited season 7 of the show premiered on July 16th this year, the episode broke all past TV viewership records, registering 16.1 million views just in the US, which also represents a 50% increase from season 6 premiere.
We need to do the same if we're gonna survive. Because the enemy is real.
The Power Pack 1 hour full of surprises, including Grammy-winning singer Ed Sheeran's cameo that broke the internet. Game of Thrones Season 7 Episode 1 became the most talked about topic on Twitter. Ironically enough, the episode was also viewed over 90 million times across the globe, making it the most pirated episode in TV history.
Time to take a quick break for the show, but hold on to your chairs. We'll be back with the unshakable and power-packed cast of Lipstick Under My Burkha. You're watching Unscripted on WION. Now, you just saw how Game of Thrones has created TV history with just the first episode of this season. Unfortunately, they can't be nominated for this year's Primetime Emmys. However, there are a whole lot of shows vying to create TV history. In fact, they've already done so at the nomination stage itself. Veteran variety show Saturday Night Live bows to 22 nominations, the highest any show has ever received in Emmy history. And tying up those 22 nominations is American comedy series Veep. So here's what you can expect from the best of American primetime television.
The biggest night in American primetime television, the Primetime Emmy Awards. And before the 69th edition of the Primetime Emmys takes to the Microsoft Theater in downtown LA on September 17th, let's get to know the biggest contenders of the coveted statuette a little better.
The nominations in the drama series
nominated for the Best Drama Series Award,
Better Call Saul,
The Crown, The Handmaid's Tale, House of Cards, Stranger Things, This Is Us, and Westworld.
The nominees for Lead Actor in a Drama
nominated
series
for Best
are
Lead Actor,
Sterling K. Brown
for This Is Us, Anthony Hopkins for Westworld, Bob Odenkirk for Better Call Saul, Matthew Rhys for The Americans, Liev Schreiber for Ray Donovan, Kevin Spacey for House of Cards, and Milo Ventimiglia for This Is Us.
Lead actors in a drama series.
Ladies receiving the nods in the Best Actress in a Leading Role
Viola
category
Davis,
include Viola Davis for How to Get Away with Murder, Claire Foy for The Crown, Elizabeth Moss for The Handmaid's Tale, Kerry Russell for The Americans, Evan Rachel Wood for Westworld, and Robin Wright for House of Cards.
On Unscripted, we take it upon ourselves to tell you which movies you need to watch and which ones you can give a miss. Check out our Unrealometer for all the details. Every week is a happening one in the world of entertainment, but not necessarily for the movies. There are few weeks which go past with barely any releases,
And then there are weeks like this one, where you'd be spoiled for choice. So much so that narrowing down on a film to watch might leave you completely baffled. But that's why we are here, to make that choice easier for you.
A perfect mix of a disaster movie and a war epic.
What has happened is a colossal military disaster.
Dunkirk revolves around the story of Allied soldiers from Britain, Belgium, Canada and France on the beaches of Dunkirk while they are surrounded by the German army during World War II.
The call went out. We have to go to Dunkirk.
Starring Finn Whitehead, Tom Glencarney and Jack Lowden, among others, the film is a crisp 106 minutes and the shortest film that the critically acclaimed director has made since his debut.
I'm on him.
An X1 directioner, Harry Styles, after marking his debut as a solo artist this year, also marks his acting debut with this film.
We've activated the civilian boats.
Civilians? We need destroyers.
Where are we going?
Dunkirk!
As per our Unreelometer, Dunkirk will keep you glued from the first frame to the last. But if you missed experiencing romance even a little, here's what you're looking for.
My father bought you.
Meet Catherine and experience her love life in 19th century rural England. Adapted from Nikolai Leskov's 1865 novel Lady Macbeth of the Metzens district. Lady Macbeth stars Florence Pugh, Cosmo Jarvis and Paul Hilton.
After creating waves in the international film circuit and a big, big trailer screening at the 18th IFAs, The Last King of Punjab, Maharaja Duleep Singh, is coming to the theatres to tell you his untold story.
What troubles you, Duleep? What bears so heavy on your heart?
The Black Prince, starring Satinder Sartaj and Shabana Azmi, will showcase Maharaja Duleep Singh's revolt against the British.
What bears so heavy on your heart?
I wish to ask something about the kingdom of my father.
Tu Maharaja banan vaste paida hoya te Maharaja hi baniya si mere putter.
You must instill in him the will and courage to take back what it rightfully is.
Written and directed by Kavi Raz, the film brings back to screen the pages of history and throws light on facts which have led to numerous misinterpretations.
The government of India wants to get rid of me and my family.
Now, if you're not a big fan of arty cinema and you love your desi Bollywood masalas, don't worry, the box office will not disappoint you.
Chalmana, ut. Dance as if there's no tomorrow.
Shake a leg, cause Sabir Khan's latest dance drama demands your perfect move. Tiger Shroff and Nawazuddin Siddiqui starrer Munna Michael revolves around a young Michael Jackson fan and a gangster who aspires to dance.
एक आदमी है, उसे 30 दिन में फर्स्ट क्लास डांसर बना दे।
कौन है वो?
The film will also see Bollywood actor Nawazuddin Siddiqui dance for the very first time.
They said it is lady-oriented. They said it is not suitable for the Indian audience. They tried to suppress their voices. But the Lipstick Brigade didn't lose hope. Overcoming all the hurdles, Lipstick finally sees the light of the day at the box office this week.
The most controversial film of the year, Lipstick Under My Burkha, has finally hit the theatres.
Lipstick mat lagao, affair ho jayega. Jeans mat pehno, scandal ho jayega. I want to ask the authorities, ki aisa kya ho jayega? Hamari azadi se aap itna darte kyu hai?
The film throws light upon women exploring their sexuality and stars Konkana Sen Sharma, Ratna Pathak Shah, Ahana Kamra and Plavita Borthakur.
Rajini, what is it?
Blouse.
Blouse?
sleepless blows.
Join the Lipstick Rebellion, get set for a blast, and don't forget to take your family along.
Well, I know with all those movies that we've just tested out for you, you'd be rushing to book your tickets right away. But hold on, there's another big release that's actually coming as a big relief to a lot of cinema lovers and artists. Lipstick Under My Burkha is finally getting a release, and we've had an exclusive chat with the cast that we will show you right after this break.
Going from day to day.
Welcome back to Unscripted. Well, this week is one of those great victories of modern day, though it is sad that such fights still have to be fought for freedom of expression. Yes, Lipstick Under My Burkha is finally going to see the light of day in India after winning many accolades at film festivals world over. The strong-willed women have fought their battles with the CBFC and have emerged victorious, but they do have plenty to say about it. Unscripted chatted exclusively with the lovely Konkana Sen Sharma, the elegant Ratna Patak Shah, and direction wizard Alankrita Srivastav.
Hi, today I'm in conversation with the star cast of the most controversial film of the year, Lipstick Under My Burkha. Thank you so much for talking to us. My first question is to you, Alankrita. Nowadays, Bollywood filmmakers are directly taking cue from the popular Hindi music lines for their titles. But you, on the other hand, came up with a title which is unusual, quirky, and it makes you think about the storyline. How did you come up with that?
Well, there's no explanation for that really. It just sort of emerged in my head. And it's a metaphoric title, so it refers to the idea that women will always have a pulsating desire to be free. And they'll always have their dreams and their own sort of ambition, their passion, even if it is sometimes secret or hidden. So even if society has sort of drawn certain boundaries for women, they can't actually stifle the inner desire and the inner dreams of women. And sometimes we don't realize, but women are... women do figure out ways of doing what they want to do, even though from the outside it seems that they're towing the line.
Okay, and of course it wasn't planned, but how did you guys react for the first time when you got to know that the film is getting so much popularity just after the first teaser got released on social media?
We were very happy that suddenly there is a spotlight on this film. This film is talking about issues that have been hidden under various carpets for a long, long time. So when you make a film like that, you do expect a little bit of shock and awe from some members of society, of course. And the fact that we've got so much curiosity makes us feel that maybe this film is doing something right.
And of course, all of you, the star cast, you belong to different age groups. So I was really excited to ask this to all of you, that when you first heard the narration or read the script, what was that first thought that came into your mind? And were there any inhibitions inside you that whether I should play this role or not?
I was very happy to get such a script, you know, because one doesn't really come across like such great roles or such well-written scripts. Usually one is looking for one or, you know, two things to, you know, to find a reason to do a film. And here I was so pleased that, I love my role, Shireen Aslam, and she's, you know, a woman in her 30s who has three kids and it's her story. And I also like the other stories of the other women, particularly Ratna's story, Usha Bua's, which is so rare. Still, we have seen younger women on screen, you know, but we've hardly ever seen, you know, older women, their whatever kind of awakening, sexual or otherwise, or, you know, women with children. I was really pleased and I loved it. I pretty much read it very quickly and said yes very quickly.
So, Ratna ma'am, how was it for you because as she said that your role
Yes, I mean, it was the most unusual role I've ever come across in film, for sure. And in India, definitely. But more than that, I really liked the idea of the film and the kind of questions it's raising. I really like the nuance in the film. There have been films made in the past about women empowerment and all that, but they are a bit like posters, you know, jhandadhari. The woman suffers, 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 and then she takes up the gun and does all kinds of exciting things. This is not that kind of film. There's no real happy ending. There's no revenge. There's no getting your back, which is the story of most of our lives. Hum log kya kya sochte hain, nahi? We imagine ki aisa hota to hum aisa karte and all that. Eventually, we just lead lives going from day to day. And this story is about that kind of lives that these four women are leading.
And of course, the film had a bumpy ride with CBFC to get the release. But, you know, on the other hand, the film got really like a good appreciation in film festivals. So do you think that somewhere we are lacking behind in terms of in comparison to our Western counterparts when it comes to issues like censorship?
In the last few years, because I think you know, the younger generation of filmmakers are really making content which is you know, they're trying to tell different kinds of stories and all of that, I think suddenly it's coming to sharp focus, this idea that we've been living with the censorship. And I think maybe time's up on censorship. And I think that if we truly want to be a free and democratic country, I feel as citizens, as audiences, as artists, as filmmakers, as people of the artistic community, I think we should be very clear that there is really no space for censorship. And we should just have a regular certification sort of process. And I think we should just say bye-bye to censorship.
But that leads to my another question, of course, to you, and Konkana, you can also step in now that you're a director. So do you think that Indian filmmakers are somewhere restricted because of this issue? These issues are not able to tell their stories to the world, no matter how good they are in their craft?
I think so. I think there's a lot of, because we know that this is the situation in our country, the way it works, I think there's a lot of self-censorship anyway. You know, which is so sad. I mean, then that's one of the things I think even Lipstick talks about in a way, that we don't allow ourselves so many things because we've internalized so much of what we are allowed and what we're not allowed, what we're supposed to speak of and where and what we can't speak of, you know, those kinds of things. So there's already this self-censorship at work. Then despite that, you know, whatever stories we want to tell, whatever content we have created, on top, that itself is again censored by another body. So I think it really is very discouraging, and it doesn't lead to any exploration of any deeper truths, I think. At least, I mean, not that every film that is doing it will lead to some kind of deeper truth, but the atmosphere has to be such that people can freely speak their minds, because we're not forcing anybody to watch the film anyway. They can watch the film if they want to.
Actually, the big argument is one of modernity versus the way things have been. In India, we haven't yet even defined the idea, concept of modernity and tradition. What do we mean by our tradition? And what do we mean when we say we want to be modern? The conflict between these two is becoming sharper and sharper. Media is feeding into that frenzy. The world outside seems to be getting more and more opinionated in a very frenzied and ugly way about this issue. What is modern? I really think we all need to first start defining for ourselves. What do I mean when I say I'm modern? Not that I wear short skirts only, but because I have a different way of looking at the world, a much more inclusive way of looking at the world.
Thank you so much for talking to us.
Well, it's been a very big week in the entertainment industry, and that's just the kind of buzz we enjoy. So whether you're a hardcore Bollywood freak or a Netflix and chill kind of soul, we'll always have something for you right here on Unscripted. Thank you for joining us, and don't forget to tune in next week. Meanwhile, do tweet to us at WION_Unscripted and tell me your take on all the latest entertainment gossip. Until next time, this is me, Pallavi Batra, signing off. We'll be right back.